first of all, you see here the inbreeding coefficient of many of the modern breeds, and they are now in alphabetic order. And for example, you see here that the coefficient of inbreeding is 0.3 for the Afghan hound, and then a little bit higher for Airedale hound. You see that it's very high, for example, for the Bull Terrier, so approaching 0.6, so that's 60% coefficient of inbreeding. Now we'll show it in a different way. So last time I showed it on alphabetic order, and now we'll show it on the inbreeding coefficient. And then you see that there's very high inbreeding on the Norwegian Lundehund, because it's there are only a very little of those dogs left, so those dogs are very similar. So they are now at, let's see, I think 0.85, so that means something like 85% or more, all the same. And then also, for example, the Bull Terrier is very high inbred. And if you look then in between the Bull Terrier, there's a Basenji, and then the miniature Bull Terrier, which is essentially the same type of dog as the Bull Terrier. But as I mentioned before in my miniature Bull Terrier video, I mentioned that the miniature Bull Terrier has been bred by breeding the normal size Bull Terrier to smaller dogs, for example Jack Russell, but also Staffordshire Bull Terrier, which has increased the gene pool. And if you then go down, you see, for example, that many breeds still have a high coefficient of inbreeding. And then at the bottom you see the Sluchi, which is the lowest coefficient of inbreeding. So this is like 5% inbreeding in the Sluchi as a breed. Chihuahua is about 10% inbreeding. So the yellow line is 10%, the green line 5%, and the red line is 25%, something like that. And that's even if you follow that red line, that you see that of many of the breeds that you have to start at the beagle or higher to have more than 25%, or stay below the beagle to have less than 25%. So the genetic diversity, for example, in the Bull Terrier, and I'll come back to this later, is very limited, as you can see here. It's almost 60% coefficient of inbreeding. And the Basenji is even higher. And the Norwegian Lundehund is even higher. Now we'll go back a little bit to the start. Sorry for skipping this, but this is the slide that I was referring to. This gives you insight in the breed-specific metrics and also includes the Bull Terrier, as you can see here. So that's this diagram. And that shows the number of samples that are needed to give insight in the homozygosity that they have displayed here. So here's the total length in homozygosity, and then you see how many samples you need to have a good insight to of 1% of initial dog homozygosity. So this gives you an insight that, for example, the Chihuahua, as I showed you before in the diagram, has a quite big spread, whereas the Bull Terrier has a quite limited spread. And Shetland Sheepdog is also a little bit in between, and miniature poodle is closer to Chihuahua, as you can see. So what's here depicted? So this, they call this a neighbor joining dendrogram. And to start off, you have the Asian breeds, sled dogs, etc., and other Asian breeds like Shoshou. Then there are some lap dogs, also from Asian nature. Then the European spitz type of dogs. Schnauzer is here, very close to the Keeshond, so to say. This is quite funny, because here is a standard Schnauzer, as you can see, standard Schnauzer. But here you will find the giant Schnauzer, see, close to the Doberman, so more of a molosser type of dog. But we will come back to that later. Then you have real
lapdogs such as the pug. You have the poodle, also a lapdog type of dog, but still a little bit more functional. This is a toy poodle. Then very small breeds like Chihuahua and other small breeds like terriers. All kinds of terriers, quite a wide band. Then you have here the German Shepherd type of dog, and other dogs that are close to it, for example the French French Shepherds, Burger, Picard. Here you have the livestock protection breeds, so those livestock protection breeds are here, for example the Commander, but also the Great Pyrenees. So contrary to popular belief, this is a different type of molosser, the livestock protection breed, than the breeds you find here, for example Saint Bernard or the Mastiff type of breeds. And also you see this later on when I mentioned the water retrieving dogs. Here you see for example running dogs of Arabic countries, and also those are completely separated from the running dogs that are more to the English sort. For example, here is the Whippet and the Greyhound. Then you go further on and then you find hounds such as the Beagle, but also Foxhounds, etc. Then you have the gun dogs like the English Springer Spaniel and other Spaniel types of dogs. And then the water dogs. And the interesting thing is you see here, for example, the Labrador Retriever depicted. And if you look then to the Newfoundlander, that's here, it's in the water dog category and not in the molosser category, neither in the livestock protection category, but close to the livestock protection. Then you see more of a all-round hunting dog, for example the Dalmatian, Weimaraner, and other dogs. Here you see the setters. Then come the Belgian Shepherds. So the funny thing is, as you remembered, here are the more of the German Shepherds, and they're quite separated from the Belgian Shepherd, as you can see here. So it includes the Bouvier des Vlaanderen, the Belgian Malinois, but also the Vuren sheepdog. And if you go further down, then you find here the English sheepdogs, and they're closer to the Belgian than they are to the German. And in between, as I mentioned, the running dogs of United Kingdom, so the Deerhound, Scottish Deerhound, and also, for example, the Irish Wolfhound, but also the Greyhound and Whippet, and all kinds of sheepdog. And now also in nurture crosses, very oftentimes they are crossing collies together with, for example, running dogs. And then, as I mentioned, the Doberman Retriever, the Doberman Pinscher, very close to the Giant Schnauzer, and also the Rottweiler. The Rottweiler makes up a little bit of the pedigree of the Doberman. And also, if you look at the Schnauzers and Pinschers in the past, you had a Pinscher with the rauw haar, as they call it, so rough-coated, that was the current-day Schnauzer. And the smooth-coated Pinscher, there are still Pinschers. The Pinscher means to bite in German. And then you find the molosses. First you see the Saint Bernard and Leonberger here, and Bernese Mountain Dog, something like that. And then you have the Canicorse and the Great Dane, more of a running mastiffs, depicted here in pinkish. And also the Rhodesian Ridgeback is in there. And then you find the true molosses, Neapolitan Mastiff, Bourbon, Bull Mastiff, and they're all more of an English type. That's a funny thing, in my opinion. And Bull Mastiff and Mastiff are closer to the Bull and Terriers. For example, the Bull Terrier, but especially the Staffordshire Bull Terrier and the American Staffordshire Terrier, than they are to the Bulldog. And how come? For example, the Bull Mastiff was once a cross between the Bulldog and the Mastiff. How come that those other dogs are closer to the Bulldog than in this case? The Bulldog part of the past than the current day Bulldogs are? Because they bred in pug. They bred in non-functional dogs to make it appear like this, and the original Bulldog looked a lot more like current day American Staffordshire Terrier or Staffordshire Bull Terrier of this list. Interesting, We'll go back to the next slide, but I'll first give you some of more details so that you can really
take a glimpse of what kind of dogs are in there. If you want to, you can pause, of course, your video and really check. Okay, we will continue now. So you remember this slide, so please remember a little bit where your favorite dog breeds are. Yes? Then we go to this slide, and it gives you some insight about the haplotype sharing. And what it tells you here is that you see the haplotype sharing across the clades, within the clades, and within breeds. Within breeds, of course, the least, but within the clades, you can still have a big diversity of haplotypes. And here you see also what there is of an exchange between all those types. Yeah. As you can see, for example, I will give you some more details. So for an example, you see here these German sheepdogs that I mentioned, and this big green line goes back to the German Shepherd dog. So, as I mentioned, those English sheepdog were closer in the genetics, but still you see here the haplotype that is also shared. And it's of course easy to be done because the Netherlands and, for example, the United Kingdom are separated by a sea, whereas there are just borders where the Netherlands is sharing the borders with Germany, but also Belgium. And of course the Belgian and the Dutch Shepherd types are more nimble and look a lot more alike. Also in this current day and age, most of the performance bred Malinois are still crossed with Dutch Shepherds and the other way around. And if it's brindle, it's a Dutch Shepherd and in the same lid. And if it's more red, they call it a Malinois, Belgian Shepherd. But also in the Malinois crosses, I'm not trying to speak French now, there is quite some blood of the German Shepherd as well to make them a little bit bigger and also cope with inbreeding depression. Next slide. So this slide talks about the extent of haplotype sharing. And also if you look there, then you see that for example, the Norfolk and the Norwich Terrier are divided into separate breeds. And first of all, you see this black line. And this is the R-square, as you can see here, is zero. This means a complete correlation. You see that all those things here are very much correlated. And for an example, Norfolk and Norwich Terrier are divided into separate breeds. They were once a working breed, so one breed. Yeah? And one had the ears erect, and the other ones had the more dropped down. And then they said, okay, we can make two show breeds out of this one working breed. And they divided those two into two separate breeds. And that has a big implication. Of course, you get two breeds, so you have more to show with. Another class, yay! But the problem is that you also cut the genetic diversity in half. And the gene pools are also cut in half. And especially if one group is bigger than the other, especially a small group will suffer very severely by inbreeding. Also, a point you see here, the Eurasia development begins with the shell cross. This is true. The Eurasia was developed first as a wolf shell cross. So they used the German, that also gives you the first part of the name, the European country, German big spitz, known as the wolf spitz, which was the biggest type of German spitz, and crossed it with a Xiaoxiao. This resulted in the wolf Xiao that was the primary Eurasian. And that was the end point. If not, those dogs had the alertness of the German spitz, and also the battle ready and aloofness and the temperament of the Xiaoxiao, which was for its size quite a man stopper, and it was a little bit too much, especially for the show people. So they bred in Samoyed to balance all things out, and that has led to the Eurasian as we know it now, also known as the Eurasian. You see again, Irish Wolfhound was
almost completely lost, and they're recovered again by Scottish Deerhound outcrosses. You see that? Closely related breeds. Also, if you look at this picture here, you see that they are now. So here's a Scottish Deerhound and Irish Wolfhound completely next to each other, so very related, even more so after this outcross program, of course. So there's also a drawback, the genetic diversity of those outcrosses is of course more, but by outcrossing they also resemble each other a lot more, so the next time you want heterosis and outcross, it would be harder to get with the same breed. So in this case, again, a deerhound would not benefit it that much. You see the silky terrier created from Yorkshire and Australian terriers, also very spot on. German wirehead pointer developed from two working breeds, the wirehead pointer Griffon and the German shorthair, which was already there. Bulldog, French bulldog and American Staffordshire terrier created Boston terrier. It was not the American Staffordshire terrier in this case, but the American Pitbull terrier of that time and age, which has resulted in the development of a show breed American Staffordshire terrier. So, as I mentioned before, there's also some sharing between the breed and haplotype exchange. That also has some drawbacks. These figures that you see here are also in there. And in this case, they look at CEA, which stands for Collie Eye Abnormality, Disease Migration. So it started with the collie, as you can see here. And of course, other collies were interbred. Yeah? So, for example, Old English Sheepdog and also dogs that went to different countries. For example, the Border Collie, but also the Australian Shepherd that was developed in the United States of America, but using European stock. But also dogs, for example, the Chinook, which is classified as a sled dog, which is false. It has some husky blood, but especially was backbred to the Chinook dog of the past, which was a cross between Saint Bernard at one side and then a Mastiff on the other side, and then they bred a lot of shepherd type of breeds, as can be seen. But also, for example, Nova Scotia Duck Tolling Retriever has some collie type of blood, and the Spaniel also has some. But even like a dog that is more of a lap dog, the Pucker, they still have this fault in them as well. They're so messed up in many ways, but even some terriers were affected. And the terrier that was affected carries some hound blood. As I mentioned in my Airedale Terrier video, the Airedale Terrier is not a true terrier. And why not? It's very big, so a terrier implies that it can go to ground. Yeah? Terra, it contains, and terra means earth. So it's Otterhound crossed with terrier, and in my opinion, my personal opinion, it's more of an otterhound, which is a hound, than a terrier. Also in character. If you look at the dog breeds in general, it's very interesting. It is in publication by Science. You see here the diversity. A giant a Great Dane, Harlequin colored, and here a black, all black Chihuahua next to it. So much, it's one species, all both came from wolves. But they can be so much different. And here they depicted what is easy to be seen. Body size, leg length, skull shape. How much you can bite is also, of course, related to skull. The length of the fur, texture, the weight of the legs. Are they very thin, like in this Great Dane? Or also in the Chihuahua, or very stiff and dense. Ear position, tip up, as I mentioned, for example, with the Norwich Norfolk there, but also in the Chihuahua you see it, and tip down with the Great Dane, etc. But these are all external factors, and in my opinion, character is at least as important. For example, if you have a similar sized Bull and Terrier, for example, Staffordshire Bull Terrier, and you compare it to the similar weight other type of animal, for example, the collie, we get completely different dogs. Or if you compare it with the Labrador, the show Labradors that they have now, they are quite heavy set, so more the same weight to height ratio. They're completely different. A Bull and Terrier is
is in his mind there to hold on and also have a very strong bite, for example, to hold on to a bull or a hog, whereas a Labrador Retriever, for example, has been developed to have a soft bite and to be very easy and not that determined. But one example at a fur length, you see, you can have, for example, like abnormalities as here. There's an insertion of this region of RSPO2 gene, and that results into the eyebrows as we now know by the standard schnauzer and all the other type of schnauzers as well. Within this dog, you don't see this. Of course, there's also the dogs with the short smooth coat, very good at heat exchange from the body to the external elements. So they are easier to cool down and not to overheat, whereas this coat would protect it. Yeah, that would be the interest, a heavier coat protected against the cold and keep warmed in. But this is just bred to have a show type of dog. Yeah. As much as show type as possible. It's not a working dog, whereas whippets are still being worked. And even within one breed, both are Portuguese water dogs. One has like more of a lion mane, soft curl, and this is completely curled up. So also a deletion, mutation, which has resulted in this diversity even within one breed. You see also that they looked at Röntgen images, which were performed on dogs, and they looked at all type of skeletal metrics, and also looked if they could find some linkage in, for example, Portuguese water dogs, and they found that very much of those were here. But also more interesting to us, that there is there a switch between small breeds and large breeds, and they found, for example, a haplotype sharing among small breeds, and all these small breeds carry this haplotype, as you see here. And I will demonstrate this later further. So here you see again that they looked at these parameters, 6, and that's correlated for more than 50% in small body size, and small body size was then determined as less than 90 pounds, which is approximately less than 40 kilograms. In my opinion, this is not a small dog, but they just had a cutoff between, in my opinion, small to medium and very big dogs, so more than 40 kilograms, and 5% only in a large breed. So the large breeds were very much dictated by this. And I will show you this even better here. This is called a heat map, and they look at distinct control large versus small. First of all, it's very important to look here. Here you see the different weight ranges. So starting from 5 to 10 pounds and up to 145 to 50 pounds. So 5 to 10 pounds is like 2.2 kilogram to 4.5 kilogram, 4.6 kilogram, and this is in kilograms. So the 150 kilograms is like 68. 150 pounds is like 68 kilograms, so quite heavy, but not the most giant. But the funny thing is that if you look here, you see that there's a sea of yellow here, and here some red points, and here also some red points. So these genes, these genetic markers, correlate especially for smaller breeds, and are absent, especially in most big breeds, almost completely. And if you look at the big breeds, it's far more interesting even. If you look here, that you see that the higher you get, especially on this IGS F1 marker, the bigger the breed gets, the more you see this. And this is immunoglobulin superfamily 1. And in 90% of large breeds, you see this allele. Heavy muscled phenotype, but can also be associated with obesity in humans. So if you have such a dog, and this is true also for the dogs, because there can be a difference between species, for example, dogs and humans, you should keep this in mind. Another factor you see here, this bulky phenotype characterized by fat back, bad fat, thickness and muscle. And this is ACSL4 here. We will come back to this later, but you see that not all the dogs that are very big need to be that fat, with that fatty back, bulky appearances. And for example, the Great Dane, as I mentioned before, is a very big dog, is a heavy dog, but is not a fat type of dog. And you can see this illustrated here. So this slide is about dog size genetics. You see here, for example, a more bulky breed, a mastiff. So you have a big chest circumference, but also a big back, as depicted here. Whereas the non-bulky breed, Great Dane, still have quite a big chest, but not an extremely fat back. And also the chest is not as bulky. Eh? And the other thing I mentioned with that fat back was first observed in pigs. And now you see, take a quick look. That bulldog, that current show type of bulldog, is very closely depicting that of a pig. And do you want that? Because what does a pig need to perform? It has to produce bulk and meat. And that's not a working type of phenotype. Show you that a little bit more. And then we go to the next. So here again an example. Of course, as I mentioned, all these specific wolves, here you see the scale from 10, all the specific dogs are derived from the wolf. You see the scale again in weight from 10 pounds, which is like 4.5 kilogram to 200 pounds, which is 81 kilogram. And the Mastiff is also known in the Guinness Book of Records as the heaviest dog recorded. And then you see this parameters again. So for example, this muscle allele, as we mentioned, is in this dog's present and not present in a wolf or not present in the small dogs. And the small dogs look a lot like the wolf, only they have this sign in small breed, which the other dogs don't have, except of the bulldog, because it has pug blood in it. It's not derived from this molossa type of dog, but it has pug blood in it. Another sign on the wall. And these are the muscle breeds, and you still have a different subset of muscle breeds that are having both. So they both have the muscle allele, but also the bulky allele. And also, if you miss this, you have the wolf factor in this direction as well. But also the thing that why those small dogs are so excellent hunters, especially terrier types. There's a miniature pincher depicted here, but was also a good ratter in its time. Is that they are very close to wolves on many of the parameters, but they just have this sign. Next slide. So as I mentioned, there can be a lot of relationships, but you can also see that there are chondroplastic breeds parameters found in many clusters, and they in the study they think this is ancient, supporting the hypothesis that those breeds are ancient. First, we will go into what is this chondrodysplastic nature, but I also want to mention it could also be not that they are all ancient, but they are developed as show breeds quite recently. I think that happened. Here you see what chondroplasticity is. So chondrodysplastic mutations, in this case you see on the left this dark Labrador, more of a normal pup, and a lighter colored Labrador which has chondrodysplastic mutations on the right. And here you see also from the Röntgen images of both. So this is the normal one and this is the chondrodysplastic one, which you see is completely out of order. But this is still a mutation within a breed that is normally not like that. But there are breeds like Dachshunds and other animals that really carry this to the extreme. So for example, in this breed, this you see even with the collie stem, that's the shell, no, not the shelties, the, what do they call those little buggers? But even in Chihuahuas, you see this, that they have those legs standing out and dwarfism. So only dwarfism in the legs in this case, but also in this small type of dogs. And within the shepherd, English shepherds, you have the corgis, which have this very chondrodysplastic mutation, very short legs, for example. Then you have also diseases in dogs. These are the top 10 diseases in dogs. So most prominent is cancer, and also very deadly, of course. And then you see the other things. So epilepsy, hip dysplasia, thyroid disease, allergies, bloat, heart disease, autoimmune disease, eye disease, and cataracts, which is also eye related. But especially cancer, let's focus there. So, for example, with some breeds come elevated risk for specific cancers. Yeah, for example, the bladder cancer, second point, is very dominant in this Scots and West Highland White Terriers, but also in Shetland Sheepdogs, but especially in the Scottish dogs. You also have osteocarcinoma, which you often find with certain pigments. And for example, gastric cancer, both in Belgian breeds, but also in Shoshone, as depicted here. Many of those dogs in the middle here, the Bernese Mountain Dogs and Flat-coated Retrievers, die of histiocystic sarcomas. Now go a little bit further. Let's start here. This is something that's very much affecting the German Shepherds, so autosomal dominant form of kidney cancer. And that means that if one dog has it, as you can see depicted here, it can very easily spread. So you only need one allele that carries it, and then you can spread it easily among your children. And what they did, they started here with this pedigree and found that this dog has contributed to all that. Also, as I mentioned before, the Scottish Terriers suffer from invasive bladder cancer, but also the West Highland White, also known as the Westie and the Shetland Sheepdogs. And it could be that these Scottish Terriers have a 20-fold chance of developing this invasive bladder cancer as compared to another dog. Really bad thing. And then you need analysis to identify predictive features and also see where the tumor is going, how bad is it? This is an important thing because it can affect all dogs. This is in this publication by Dekker et al. And it's called The Long and Lonely Life of a Canine Transmissible Tumor. So here you see all kinds of interaction between all the dog breeds, a little bit different than we showed you before. And this canine transmissible vulnerable tumor, CTVT, is something that can be translated by sexual transfer. So if a dog and a bitch have sexual intercourse, then they can transmit those cells, and then the other dog has them as well. And it is a global phenomenon. That's important things to see. And they wanted to see if there is a shared origin. Then the hypothesis was, if they looked, could it be that one was the donor of all that, and some died, and et cetera, but they had a modern tumor that they need, and they had a modern tumor of a Brazilian Cocker Spaniel, but also of a village dog. And here is an Australian cattle dog depicted. It could be that it closest resembled that type of dog. And what they found out, if you look here, let's start here, that they had a specific, perhaps this is better. They found that the cancers, as you remember, this Australian cattle dog would further look more like a collie type of dog, as more in that direction. It's now flipped about a little bit. So different as we depicted before. Here you see wolves. So it was not a wolf type of dog, but it was closest resembling that of a Siberian husky, as you can see here. So and both were, both you see the, I'll show you the next picture. You see that blue one is of the Cocker Spaniel and the red one is of that Australian village dog, and they both closest resemble that of a Siberian husky. And that was what I wanted to tell you. This is again the inbreeding coefficient, but now in alphabetical order. So if you want to look for your dog, not all dogs were in there, but it gives you a little bit of insight. So again, you see that the red line is like 25%, yellow line is like 10%. And the green line you see here is like 5%, so keep that in mind if you want to see your dog. And again, the same with now inbreeding coefficient as a selection tool to divide all the type of breeds. So for example, if you're looking for a dog that has less than 40% inbreeding, you would have to take a line from the 40% and take it here, and you can only start, for example, at the Pekingese or lower, and all those other dogs are just too high of inbreeding, if you want to look at that way. But the coefficient of inbreeding is not the most important factor, because if you inbreed on healthy dogs, you can still have good dogs. Also in wolves, there's of course quite a lot of inbreeding. But it's a pity that they have sacrificed genetic diversity just in favor of show dogs. You see the Australian cattle dog, for example, quite a healthy breed compared to many, and also quite long living. Okay, have a great day. Please do subscribe to our channel if you like our content, and if not, feel free to leave a dislike or like if you do like our content. Have a great day. Bye bye.